We're going to be looking at chapter 1, just verses 1 and 2. We're starting Ephesians chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. One thing that we love to do here, will do here at Redemption Hill, is just to walk through books of the Bible. We like to just take a book of the Bible verse by verse, and we just feel like that's kind of what's best for us in our growth, and it kind of forces us to kind of handle everything and think through everything in Scripture and not just kind of pick and choose. And so that's just kind of what we do. We pick a book of the Bible and we'll kind of roll through it together and see what God has to say for us there. So today it's going to be pretty introductory. I want us to really get a good feel for what Paul's talking about when he writes the book of Ephesians and how it affects us as individuals and as the church body. And so we're going to dive into that. If you don't have a Bible, if you're here, I know a lot of people today, they just want to use an app on their phone or iPad or whatever. That's totally great. But if you don't have a hard copy of a Bible, if you would like one, we would love to give you one. So if you want to just check with the welcome table on your way out, you can take one of those. It's free. It's actually one that, it's not a paperback. It's nicer. And we would love for you guys just to take that. I would even say if you have a friend that doesn't have a Bible, and you think if you gave them one, they might read it, go ahead and take one of those. We run out this week, fantastic. We'll get more for next week. But we just want to be able to bless you guys and make sure you have God's Word in front of you. So let's read our text. Hopefully you're there. If you're not in the book of Ephesians already, look in the New Testament. You're about the halfway mark of the New Testament. You'll probably hit Ephesians, and it should be on our screen for us if we can get it there. But let's just read those first two verses together. God says this, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God, to the saints who are in Ephesus and are faithful in Christ Jesus. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me set this up by asking a question this morning. I know many of you are probably coming in from different backgrounds. Maybe some of you are Baptist. You're probably on the back row. Your hands were in your pockets the whole time we were singing. That's totally great. We love you. We're glad that you're here. But you can participate here. I'm going to ask if you know someone. I would be shocked if anybody knows anybody or knows this person. But how many of you guys have ever heard of Hedy Green? Hedy Green. Anybody? Nobody. She was alive in the late 1800s, early 1900s. How many of you have heard of The Wolf of Wall Street? Yeah, everybody. Leonardo DiCaprio, right? So you know him. Well, Hedy Green was actually known as the Witch of Wall Street. She's not somebody that you probably would have heard of, but at the turn of the 1900s, she was one of the richest people in the world, and she was known as the Witch of Wall Street because she was incredibly cutthroat when it came to business, and she was also incredibly stingy when it came to money. She was one of the most wealthy people in the world, but no one would have been able to know that just by looking at her. She was an extreme hoarder of her finances, and when she actually died in 1916, she had somewhere in today's value of about $3 billion to $4 billion. She was extremely wealthy. But again, extremely cutthroat business and extremely stingy with her money. She said that she learned that from her dad, who told her as she was growing up to owe nothing to no one. Not even niceness and not even a smile, he told her. So you can imagine with growing up with that kind of dad and that kind of atmosphere, she's probably not the person that you're going to call and find out to hang out. But she did make a lot of money. And she was a very, very wealthy individual, but again, extremely stingy. There's stories of her, you can look them up, of her actually living in a modest home and eating oatmeal. First of all, there's another part of that story. First of all, if I'm that wealthy, like I'm not even wealthy at all, and I eat out as much as possible. Like oatmeal is not in my cabinet. But she ate oatmeal, but she also ate oatmeal cold because she didn't want to pay for the electricity it would take her to heat that water up so that she could make her oatmeal hot. This is how stingy she was. There's another story of her and her son, actually, and her son had a severe leg injury, and she took him to a free clinic. And when she took him to that clinic, they were like, we cannot help him, this is a serious injury, you really need to take him to a specialist. They gave her the specialist's name, they expected her to go to that, but she was too stingy with her finances to take her son, her own son, to the doctor that he needed. She decided she would take care of him at home. And he ends up getting an infection and is like him losing his leg. So here's this lady, like hopefully every single one of us in the room, and I would probably have some coupon cutters and tack pads for the wallet, but I hope like she's crazy. Like, this is a perfect example of someone who has all the resources at their fingertips, but we would look at them and say, you have absolutely no idea who you are and how to use the resources that are available to you. You're completely confused at who you are and what you have. And listen, I think a lot of times in our lives, and I'm going to ask you this morning just to investigate your hearts and really allow yourself to be open. I know it's the first time. I mean, it's weird. I feel like a guest speaker here, right? But so I know it's all of ours first time. So let's just get past that. And let's just allow ourselves to let God just kind of speak to us. Open our minds, open our hearts, and really think through some things. Because I think a lot of times, as believers, especially, we live our lives as people who don't know who we really are and what we really have. We might have some head knowledge of what we have and who Christ is and what he's done and all of that brings us in our salvation and in our Christian life. We hear about it all the time, and we might be able to even recite some of the things that Christ does for us when we place our faith in him, but we live as people who don't understand or live in the realities of those things on a day-to-day basis. In fact, it goes so far from our grasp. Maybe for the unbeliever sitting here this morning, the seeker, we are so glad that you are here. In fact, we're just as much here for you as for anyone else. We're glad that you're here this morning, but maybe you just don't even know. Maybe you're just confused. I don't know who I am or what I have. I'm just trying to make it in this world, and you're just trying to kind of figure out what is it that I need to pursue and chase after next to actually have a little bit of satisfaction. And I think because we don't really know who we are, and we don't really know how to live in that reality, it causes a whole lot of confusion in our lives. A whole lot of heartache. Maybe even fear and anxiety. Maybe even depression. And wondering what our purpose is. And wondering around in the world just kind of going, man, I don't even know. I know that maybe even the realities of who God is, I can speak that truth to others, but I have zero capability of walking in it day to day. It's an accident if I fall into one of these things that I would say I even know. And I wonder if some of us just kind of feel like we're kind of wandering in this world, and I think this book, Ephesians, addresses us. It takes those of us who are struggling, and Paul's writing it to the struggling believer and for the unbeliever to see what they might actually have in Christ. But listen, there is a feast of life that is offered up to us. We don't have to starve. We don't have to wonder where we're going. We don't have to wonder about our meaning, our purpose. There's joy that is reality. We don't have to live in sorrow and pain, wondering what circumstance will determine how we live our life and how we feel. There's real peace and there's real rest in the fact that everything has been done on your behalf, so we don't have to live in anxiety and fear. There's real purpose. We don't have to wander in the world and try to seek out and try to fall into what we're supposed to do and how we're supposed to act. There's a reality of purpose and meaning that is there for us. We don't have to live for love from the approval of others, because there's love outside of others that allows us to love people well and care for people the way that we have been called to, because we are loved in the one who has created us. There's victory. We don't have to live in defeat. There's a loving family that we can be a part of. We don't have to live as though we're lost and alone and seeking community. There's a community that is there for us. We're not isolated. You don't have to be alone. See, the book of Ephesians is written to us as believers who have everything that we've ever longed for and everything that we were created for, but struggle to live in the realities that they bring. Those truths are right at our fingertips. And we can live in that truth. That's why Redemption Hill exists, to push one another and have community around this truth, that we might lead one another into a reality of every day learning what it looks like to more and more live in the truth of who God is. And for the unbeliever, I get to see that this is real. That everything you lay down at night and wonder, is there more? Is there something? Is there some sort of satisfaction? Is there something out there that will actually fulfill what I'm longing for? The answer is yes. There is that reality. And so when we started thinking and praying about what is the first text of scripture that we're going to walk through together as a church, we went to Ephesians because I think we need to get a handle on the book of Ephesians in our lives. The first three chapters are all about who we are in Christ, and the last three chapters are all about what that looks like when the rubber hits the road and how we actually live that out in our life together as the church family. And so for the next 12 weeks, we're going to discover freedom together. And I promise you, if you're here, then freedom will be discovered, and you will learn to walk in it more and more hand in hand with me and the one sitting next to you as we learn what it means to be community together, and we learn what it means to walk in the truth of who God has created us to be. And in light of that this morning, let me ask you a question. And here's where I really want you to think. Here's where I really want you just to allow yourself, your mind to be open, your heart to be open, because I really want you to investigate this in your heart and mind this morning. And here's the question. Who are you? Who are you? How would you describe your being to someone? How would you kind of investigate your heart and say, this is the word, or this is the phrase, or this is the thing that I would define myself as? It's the ultimate in my life. What fills in the blank when I ask you the question, or you make the statement, I am, ... What's the first word? Maybe it's I'm rich, maybe it's I'm poor. Maybe it's I'm smart, maybe it's I'm not. Maybe it's that I'm pretty good looking, I'm getting through life that way, or I'm not very good looking, and I think about it subconsciously all the time. Maybe it's that I'm single, and all I can think about is where is my mate. Or maybe it's that I'm married, and all I can think about is making my spouse happier than making me happy. Or maybe it's that I'm divorced, and I feel like I've failed. Or maybe it's my kids. Or maybe it's my lack of kids. Maybe it's what I do as a career. There can be all sorts of things. Maybe you feel like a failure, or maybe you feel like a success this morning. And maybe you would even say, like, Brandon, I know the right answer. We're sitting in church. Right? And so what if I ask you, here's another opportunity to respond. Like, what if I ask you, who is the most important person in all the world?
Jesus.
Husbands, that was a perfect opportunity for you to yell your wife's name. And you blew it. You could have just got some major crowded points. Jesus, right? The first thing, we know the answer to that. And so I know, even sitting up here, and I know a lot of you, I don't know a lot of you, but I can guess that you know a little bit about Christianity. And when I start talking about who are you, then you can start talking about the gospel, maybe. We're going to explain that in just a second. You can start talking about Jesus. And I can do this with my small group all the time. But then I gotta look them in the eye and I gotta go, okay, that's where your head is, but where's your heart? Who are you? Maybe you know the right answers, maybe you don't, maybe you're wondering, I don't know. And sometimes that's a really scary thing for us, but the only thing more scary than not knowing at all, because there's hope in not knowing, right? Maybe I'm awesome, I don't know. But maybe some of you are like, man, I know exactly who I am, and then you gotta come to grips with the reality when you lay down at night and look up at the stars or whatever it is, and you're kind of having those moments of deep thought, that isn't satisfying you. That's even more scary. There's not a whole lot of hope in that. And so the question this morning is, who are you? So again, really, I ask this because if you look back in verse 1, this is where Paul starts. And here's what I want to kind of draw out this morning, that writing this book, he would have answered that question that I just asked you a lot differently than he answers it here in verse 1. He was a totally different person. And there was a truth that broke into his life that we'll see in just a second that totally shifted his identity. And everything that he was no more, and everything that he is something that is new, is something outside of him, is something that is greater than anything in this world that could possibly define him or possibly take away his identity. And he's going to lay it out for us in this book. But I want to just kind of draw this reality and this truth towards us just a little bit, because I think a lot of us aren't going to answer this question if we're truthful with ourselves the same way that Paul does in verse 1. So I'm going to look at maybe how he got there, because I think in the past he might have answered this a lot differently. And you don't have to turn there, but if you looked at Philippians 3, Paul gives us a little bit of his past, a little bit of his resume, a little bit of who he was before Christ and what he found identity in before Christ. So here's what he says. I'll read this to you. Philippians 3, 4 through 6. He says, if anyone else thinks that he has reason for confidence in the flesh. And I'll stop right there just for a second, because I have to start thinking about this. What does he mean by that? If anybody else has reason to have confidence in the flesh. And so what he's saying to us this morning is, if anyone has reason to have confidence in identity, that you will be satisfied in the work of your hands. If anyone here has confidence that they will be satisfied in their identity with their family, their wife, their kids, the title that they have at work, the things that they have accomplished, their intellect, their beauty, their relationships with friends, their finances, their children's abilities, whatever it may be in the flesh, whatever humanity has to offer, if that is where your identity is and you feel that that would satisfy you, then he says these words, I have none. If there was any reason to have confidence in this world, I've had it. And then he tells us why. And in this culture, this would have been a pretty fantastic resume. He says this, verse 5. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin. Beautiful lineage. Says, I'm a man among men. I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews. As for the law, I'm a Pharisee. I'm the pinnacle of authority. People in this culture and in this society would have striven to be Paul. He says, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. He's saying, man, I have got it going on. Like, if it is of the flesh, if it can satisfy you in this world, like, I know. Because basically what he says here is, naturally, this is who everyone would want to be. And I think a lot of us, when we see people like Paul would have been in the world, that's the person we're asking, man, how do I find satisfaction the way you found satisfaction? You've got everything I want. So just tell me what to do, Paul. Like, tell me what to do to have what you have, because I see what you have, and culturally speaking, man, that is everything that I'm longing for. So can you just tell me what I need to do in and of myself, the direction that I need to go to have those things, because I think that's what I need to be satisfied. And you fill in the blank with whatever that might be. Paul says, man, I was there. And see, typically, when we think of who we are, it is a culmination of our past, good or bad. In our culture, it is a culmination of what people have thought we looked like or don't look like. Of what we've done and what we haven't done. Of our finances or our lack of finances. What house we live in or don't live in. What car we drive somewhat and what car we don't drive. This is how we define ourselves. But here's the thing. And I just invite you to be honest with yourself this morning. Again, I wonder if any of those things are ever satisfying. They haven't been. The more I learn, the more I want to learn. The because I realized I knew little less than I thought I knew before. The more like I get, the more money I get, the more money I want. The more materials, like I've got a problem with Amazon, the more materials that I get, listen, I got Amazon Prime, and it's the one thing, if I buy one thing all year, it's Amazon Prime. There's a lot of times I order something on Amazon Prime, and it takes a whole 2 days to get there. It doesn't even satisfy me by the time it arrives. I'm already on Amazon before that thing arrives, looking for the next best thing that will satisfy me for what I can purchase. And so I don't know about you guys, but I've never been able to find anything that actually satisfies me. I'm always wanting more. And it's actually, if you're just honest with yourself, man, it's exhausting, isn't it? Trying to keep up with everything, to constantly pursuing and chasing after joy and satisfaction and meaning and purpose and constantly wondering if it's out there or if I have it. And I guarantee you, even if you're sitting here this morning and you're like, man, I'm good. Like, I feel, Brandon, I can tell you, I'm totally satisfied right now. Then I guarantee you, you're worried about losing whatever it is that you think you're satisfied with. Because it won't be there forever. Because we don't live in a world of forevers. Everything you've ever had has gone. Everything that you've ever had has been alive, will soon pass, nothing less. And if you don't have it, you're sitting here thinking, this is what I think I need to get, then you're constantly worried about getting it. Only to get it and realize now I'm constantly worried about losing it. So we're just in this cycle of continually never finding satisfaction. Can I tell you something this morning? That I said at the beginning, you don't have to live there. We don't have to live that way. There's a rich identity available to us outside of who we are and what we've done. And nothing in this world can take it away, and nothing in this world can add to it. There's an identity out there that we were created for. Paul is letting us into that insight. We're going to dig into it deeper over the next several weeks together. This is what Paul understands. Because we might expect him to say, and start this letter with some credentials about himself. All right, Paul, you're about to write a letter to the church. Why should we listen to it? Are you actually someone who can tell me what to do to get everything that I want? And he doesn't start the letter that way. He doesn't start this letter about living in the riches of all that we were created to have, experience, and long for, as a you can gain your identity by doing X, Y, Z. And it's not a self-help kind of book. And he lets us see that right off the bat. Instead, he says, you can have the identity you desire. The identity that we must live in to begin to understand the mysteries of all that we long for, all that we were created for, which we'll talk about in the coming weeks in the book of Ephesians. He says, listen, you can have it, but look at my words. It's not about my work. It's not about what I've done. It's about my surrender to one who's done everything on my behalf. I, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. I love how he starts most of his letters that way. Says he's an apostle because he actually saw Christ. He was actually before Christ. You read Acts chapter 9 to see his experience when he went from one man to another. His identity completely changed and shifted. And he became an entirely new person. And the person that he was, who had everything that man could want, is pale in comparison to the one that he became in Christ. And he's telling us that. He says, look, I've encountered Christ. And when I've encountered him, I understand that Jesus, listen, plus nothing equals everything that I was ever created to have, and ever longed to have, and now it's at my fingertips. And then I'm going to share with you throughout the book of Ephesians, how do you actually walk in those realities? How do you live out this truth? That you can have everything that you were created to be satisfied with. Paul says, this is all that I am, so it's all that's worth me proclaiming that I am Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ. So here's what we can take from these first few words that transforms the way that we see the rest of this book. said to me, hey, you are mine. And that opened my eyes to the reality of what I was created to know and believe and what I was created to do. And then from that point forward, Paul has no questions because he knows who he is and therefore he knows what to do. That's what we're going to be discovering in this book. That Jesus came down to this earth and lived a perfect life on our behalf, because no matter how good you are, you fall short of his perfection. Paul's a perfect demonstration of that. He lived the perfect life on our behalf. And listen, he paid the penalty for our imperfection. He went to a cross and he died for our sin. That we might be forgiven of all that we are. We might take on a new identity, the identity of Christ. And that identity might make us righteous for who he is and what he's done, not what we are and what we've done. And he rose from the grave to overcome our sin and our penalty of death, that we might one day be with the Father for all of eternity. And right now, Christ is sitting in this very moment, interceding on your behalf if you know him. And he's declaring over all of our brokenness that he is righteous and you are his. There is extreme strength in that identity. And that's what Paul is declaring. And when he says that, when he hung on the cross and said, it is finished, and that identity becomes our identity, we place our faith completely 100% by grace, nothing that we have done but all that he has done, then all of a sudden, all that Christ is and all of his inheritance and all that he is as the Son of God is placed upon us. Those are the truths of what we have now. Those are the truths that we live in for all of eternity, and those are the truths that we can experience in our hearts and in our lives here. Those are the things that need to begin to play out in this room. Those are the things that need to begin to play out as we leave here and go on mission throughout the week. That we belong to Christ. So he says, I write to you, listen to this, this is so beautiful. I'm writing to you a book about how to live and all the promises that you have in Christ. And I'm writing to you as one that's been satisfied in Christ. I write to you as one that can rest. I write to you as one that has peace, because all the work's been accomplished. See, the answer to the question, man, is there more? I wonder if you've ever asked that before. You just kind of looked up, you've had a deep thinking moment, and you're like, and the answer to that question, Paul says, yeah, there's more. And it's found in having the identity of who says it's finished. I've accomplished it. And he declares to us his first words here. Here are my credentials. I have what you long for. I was with him. I've seen him. I've heard from him. And by the will of the one who created all things, the one who redeems what has been broken by sin, I'm writing to you, the saints who are in Ephesus, and all of those who have placed their faith in Christ Jesus, that there is a satisfying truth. Listen, don't miss it. Don't miss it. That's a beautiful identity. This is why Paul's proclamation of who he is so wonderful. Because it's not only freeing from who we have been, or to do what you don't have, or have what you don't have, or to do what you haven't done. It's restoring you to what you're actually meant to be. God said, let us make mankind in our image, after our likeness. And we'll talk about the us in the coming weeks. That right there, though, is identity language. That's who you are. Listen, you are made in the image of God. And then he says that that identity gives us something. That identity gives us unity with God. It gives us unity with God to one another, and then we have dominion over all other created things. And God said it was very good, and it says that he blessed them. I think this is being blessed with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places. This is what we're going to see next week in verse 3. How does this relate to God restoring us to who we were created to be? And in verse 3 of chapter 1, we have one of the most confusing verses in my life that I've ever read. And I think But listen, if we lose that identity, we begin to search for identity in creation, that we were actually created, it says here, to lead. And listen, just as a side note quickly, I think this creates the culture that we all find ourselves in where there's a whole lot of tension and unrest. Because for our man-made identity, whatever it is that we find that identity in, to be fulfilling, we have to take pride in that identity and make it seem like it's better than other identities that would be different than ours. Because if another different identity is better, then that demeans our identity. And so therefore, it's always going to cause division when we take pride in our differences and find identity in how I'm different than you. It'll always cause division. We lose sight of being in the image of God, and we find identity in our differences, and it pushes us to opposite sides. And so just quickly, I'll just say, listen, the world will never find unity and peace and love that we all desire and want outside of finding Jesus. Because only in Him do we have identity outside of our differences, identity that leads to humility and love, because it's not about us. It's not about who I am and what I've done. It's about Him and who He is and what I was created to be. And we're all image bearers. Therefore, as a church, we will always fight against racism. We will always fight against sexism. We will always fight against classism. We want all people because all were created in America. And we want more diversity in this place. We were all created in His image. And we are brought together by the gospel. We'll talk more about that in the series, but in short, any identity found in things of this world will enslave you, they will tame you, they will train you to live in fear and uncertainty and pride and to lose sight of who you really are and what you're really meant to have in your Creator. So listen. We lost sight of the reality of Genesis 1 because of sin separating us from the pure and perfect God. All of our brokenness separates us. And Jesus came so that we could know what it means to be, to live the life that we were created to have. And He did all the work for us to be restored back into that relationship with God. So Paul almost always begins his letters with, I am in Christ. That's my identity. I've been redeemed. By the will of God that I am who I am. And I was created by God to give Him glory. And in that I have joy and fulfillment. And it's the only identity that Paul can actually use that can actually be strong enough for what follows to live a restored and fulfilled life. So let's close. Look very quickly at verse 2. There's a double blessing to this type of identity. It says, grace to you and peace. Grace here is a predominantly New Testament word, right? It's a grace that we are saved. It's grace that we have, common grace, that we have breath, that we have life, that we have all of the things that we have. It's a grace to us that we are saved. It's a grace to us that we're sustained in our salvation. It's a grace to us that we will one day be with God for all of eternity. There's nothing that we can do to be restored back into who we were created to be. There's nothing that we can do to gain an identity that is satisfying at it's all Christ. It's grace. The second word there is predominantly an Old Testament word, the word shalom, peace. And so Paul here is saying, listen, Jesus is the fulfillment of both. Because it is by His grace that you have peace, and there is no peace where there is no grace. So grace to you and peace to you from the Creator and Savior and Lord, to those who are in Him and growing in that understanding. Here's what I want us to take away this morning. If you're a follower of Christ, and you would be honest enough to say this morning, man, I know the truth of Christ, I place my faith in Him, it is by grace that I have been saved, but man, it is a process that is killing me to walk through and understand and to walk this life in a way that is fulfilling, it is joyful, and all of those promises seem way out of my grasp. You're in the right place. Because we're going to be a community that walks in those truths. you're someone this morning that we honestly have to say, man, I don't know Jesus. I don't have that identity. And I hope you would see that it is the only identity that's worth having. It's the only identity that will save. It's the only identity that will satisfy. Place your faith in Christ and all that He has done to take on His identity for what He has done on your behalf.